Better get cracking. Did anybody need a lab notebook that they didn't get last time? Were you good? Okay. And I brought everything with me this time, so if you're missing anything and you need another copy, I've got them. I guess that's it as far as business goes. Any, you had a chance to read the chapters at least? No. That's not a good sign. Right, because you're not going to get everything you need in just one lecture. You read the chapter, give the lectures, and then we'll do the reviews. And that's where a lot of the learning takes place. Right, when you have to use what you've learned to solve problems. That's what it's about.
Is that the section part of the same page? Is that graded? And there's like a few, like a
the homework. Points?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's part of it
too.
Some, and they were one question has like six parts. Questions.
Yeah. I tried to rate the points for the problems. It has sections, then I gave points to each section. It only totals up the total point for that problem, even though it has several sections. But you might see one that has six sections and I mean 12 points, so 2 points each. Yeah, you get exposure to certain types of problems in the homework and different types of problems in the review document. So hopefully both of them will work together to kind of coalesce topics in your head. The more of these problems that you work, the better. So if you're limit on time and try to maximize the effect by working every other problem, at least in the review document, because it's not graded. But of course, the homework is graded, so we'll do all of those. Okay, I'm going to leave the door open because it feels a little warm in here to me. Oh, what am I forgetting? I'm forgetting. The magic wand. Here we go. We don't see it works. Yeah, there it goes. Put that up here. Lock it in place until I need it. Okay. Today we're going to look at chapter 2. And we're going to get a little bit of background, historical background for the concepts behind atoms and molecules. And then at the end of the chapter, we're going to learn how to name compounds. Right? If we're not speaking the same language, then we're never going to understand each other. And there's a certain way that chemists speak. And it has rules. All right, so you're going to get an ordered way of naming compounds and writing the compounds. And in order to do that, you need to know those element symbols. Right? If you're not working on them diligently yet, you need to do that. Learn those symbols because that's the alphabet for chemistry, right? The ones that handout that I gave you with the red boxes around, the ones that I want you to learn, there's about 60 of them, I think. Okay. So, believe it or not, chemistry started a long, long time ago. It just wasn't called chemistry. The ancient Greeks had ideas about how the natural world worked. And their explanations were okay for the time, but the chemists the Greeks were not noted as experimentalists. Right? They did a lot of stuff up here. In fact, young students, when they learned things like geometry, and their rudimentary trigonometry and music, whatever it was, they memorized everything. If they had to use diagrams or representations of what they were learning. They just drew it in the dirt. Now, to be sure, they did have some writing course, right? Everybody knows the Greeks had an alphabet and a language and everything, but still, they didn't experiment, right? They just said, this is what I think it is, and they went with it. If it was a good explanation, they didn't question it like we do these days. Then through the Middle Ages, we had, I don't know, I call them kitchen chemists, the alchemists. Right? They would work their magic with different chemicals that they knew at the time, trying to do certain things. And of course, they get the most common trick that was assigned to them was trying to turn lead into gold. But actually, what they're really after was the elixir of life. And even Isaac Newton was an amateur alchemist. But they were based upon, got another one. No. Must have dropped out and come back in. Okay. When I hear a ding-a-ling, I know something's happening. but the transmission of information was different for the Middle Ages and alchemists than it is for us today. It was based upon the same thing, the same process that they used to train. The word's just gone right out of my head. Train craftsmen. You had a master craftsman, and that craftsman took on an apprentice. And very often, the apprentice would live in the shop. And the apprentice would work until they mastered the techniques, and they would go out on their own as journeymen until they had acquired enough experience and had satisfied the conditions of their particular guild that they could become masters. And so that's the way information was transferred, and that's the way that the alchemists did it. They had apprentices also, like the sorcerer's apprentice, right? And they learned things as if they were recipes, right? They didn't really understand, like I was talking about before, they didn't understand what you see at the macroscopic level. What you sense is due to actually things going on at the microscopic level. They didn't make that connection. The first, what we would consider a modern chemist, an experimentalist, was Robert Boyle. He was an Englishman, and we're going to get exposure to Robert Boyle later. I think it's chapter 5, we talk about gases. We'll get Boyle again. But he believed in experimentation, and this was in the middle 17th century, I believe, to test whether his hypothesis was correct. And in fact, he was the first one to come up with the definition for an element. What is an element? Well, there were others that came along with him and after him, and they developed these laws. Like we, in chapter 1, remember, a law is what? It's just an explanation of what's happening. It says, if you do these things, if you put these things together, you do it in a certain way, you always get this result. And there's no explanation for why it does that. So these laws developed first before we started trying to explain why in terms of theories and models. And one of those was developed by Antoine Lavoisier, obviously a Frenchman. And his law, his discovery was the law of conservation of mass. So during a chemical reaction, the mass of the reactants is equal to the mass of the products. In other words, you cannot create mass, cannot destroy mass in a chemical process. If you're missing anything in the reactants that showed up in the products, then it has to be due to experimental error. You missed some product. You're making a product that you're not accounting for. He said that this law, this conservation of mass, is a law. Well, Lavoisier unfortunately had the misfortune of being active at the time of the French Revolution. And before the revolution got started, he wasn't making quite enough money doing his experimental stuff. So he bought a contract from the king of France to collect taxes. And people thought about tax collectors then the same way we do now, right? Everybody hated them, right? Unfortunately, when the French Revolution rolled around, an invention came along with it. This doctor, his name was Guillotin, invented this device for humanely ending someone's life. Right? And just chopped your head off in a split second. And Lavoisier succumbed to that problem. He was picked up by the, I don't know what you call it then. Communism hadn't been invented yet, but they had the same feelings. Right? They were totalitarians. Anyway, Lavoisier lost his life in the French Revolution. Then along came Proust, who was another Englishman. And his law was that he discovered was that a compound always contains exactly the same proportion of the elements by mass. So if you've demonstrated a compound, in other words, if you've got this substance that you've been able to separate, say it's a mixture, and you separated these substances until you've established one is pure, then this is by physical means only. Then if you use chemical means to separate its parts, and using Boyle's definition of an element, you've been able to establish that this element, this element, this element, maybe however many it is, and you ratio them by mass. So many grams of this one, so many grams of that, so many grams of this one in a 100-gram sample. Then you ratio them to the 100, you've got a percent, right? So your percent composition of each element is fixed for that compound. And you identify the compound by its behavior, both chemical and physical behavior, and that sets it apart from all other compounds. Well, he said, it doesn't matter what the source of the compound, no matter where you get it, where, for instance, water, if we purify water by distillation, right, and you get pure water, or if you make water by reacting hydrogen and oxygen together in the space shuttle engine, and you get that water, you compare those two compounds, they're exactly the same by ratio mass, mass ratio of the elements. That was the law of definite proportions. Those mass proportions of elements are always the same for a compound, no matter what the source. Okay? Then there was a law that John Dalton came up with. He was another Englishman that came along a little later. We'll hear from him again very soon. His law of multiple proportions was simply that if you had a compound composed of two elements, for argument's sake, I'll say from X and Y, and you have another compound of this made from the same two elements, but it's a different compound, then if you hold one of them constant, right, the same amount of each one, and you have more than one compound, it's okay, then the ratio of the other element, the ones to each other, are whole number ratios by mass. Now, we understand that today, if we write this compound, this would be one of those, this would be two of those, and this would be three of those, for instance. Right? We understand that is the reason why, but they didn't know that then. They just knew that if you had a series of compounds, and they were made from the same two elements, and you hold one of those elements at the same mass, then the ratio of the other element's masses to one another is a whole number ratio. Okay? Does that go like this or in here and out there? Okay? I understand. that's why I put it in black and white. So if you read that, it might make more sense. This was Don Dalton's law of multiple proportions. Now, later on, Dalton is going to take all of these laws together and blend them into a theory. Right? We'll talk about that in a minute and explain why all of this happens. why all these laws are true using his theory. And, oh, here we are. I didn't realize it was coming up that quick. So this is at the beginning of the 19th century. Dalton's atomic theory, the first premise of his atomic theory is that each element is made up of tiny particles called atoms. So you have this element that, you know, if you separate it by physical means and you keep separating, right, halvesies, 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 eventually you get down to two and you split those. Now you have one particle. That's an atom. But all the atoms from that element are, they have identical properties. Okay, so that defines your element. So these tiny particles are atoms, and Dalton actually borrowed that concept from the ancient Greeks. The ancient Greeks believed this also, that everything that we could see in the universe was composed of elementary particles called atoms. The difference is that the ancient Greeks thought that there was only one kind of atom, and everything was made of that atom. Right? So they had difficulty explaining why, well, if we have this element of gold and this element of lead, and they're made of the same element, why do they have different properties? So they went through all kinds of mental gyrations and came up with their four elemental forces, wind, air, fire, and water, and all that stuff, trying to explain why they, how they could make one atom do all these things. Well, Dalton said, you know, it's not that way. They're the elementary particle for the element, yes. But each atom of different elements is different. Right? The atom of lead is different than the atom of gold. And that just, you know, that solved the problem right there in one statement. And that's what this statement is. Now, he didn't explain why the atoms were different. He just says that they were different. Right? We haven't come to the part where we know why one atom of an element is different than the atom of another element. We'll get there. I know you're on the edge of your seats waiting for that explanation. And he also said that compounds are formed simply from combinations of these elements. Right? And by combining the elements in different proportions and different ways, whatever that might be, you get different identities of compounds. And you have a compound of nitrogen and oxygen like that, or like that, or like this, right? Or even like this. And they're all made of nitrogen and oxygen, but they're different ratios of each one of those elements. And these are each very different identities, right? You know this one right here, if you've ever been to the dentist, that's laughing gas, nitrous oxide. Okay? So that's what this premise of his theory is explaining. Compounds are formed from a combination of different atoms and different numbers of atoms. Right? So this means that there are three oxygens and one nitrogen. And he also said that when you react elements and compounds together to produce something new, different substances, that all that happens is just you rearrange them. They just swap partners. So we know that, go back to our example, hydrogen gas, that little G means gas, and oxygen gas together will yield water. That's a liquid. Okay, so that means there's two. I'll show you how to do that later. So this has a characteristic. Hydrogen gas is an identity of its own, oxygen's identity of its own, the water's different. But all we did was just rearrange the atoms. Okay? That's one of Dalton's premises for his atomic theory. Okay, so we're going to leave Dalton for now and get some more information, for lack of a better term, under our belts. there were simultaneously with Dalton, there were two researchers, Gay-Lussac and Avogadro. I think they were both Italian. I know Avogadro was Italian. And they were working with gases. Gay-Lussac measured, under the same conditions of temperature and pressure, volumes of gases during a reaction. So he would say that if we reacted, let's see, we had two volumes of hydrogen and one volume of oxygen, gives you two volumes of water, as long as you keep the temperature and pressure the same. And he was studying reactions that way. Well, the odd thing about that is we're saying 2 + 1 = 2, right? Mathematically speaking, that's not right. But chemically speaking, it's a fact. It was an experimental fact. So Gay-Lussac's work and then Avogadro's hypothesis followed, explained why this happened. And it, I don't know which came first, the chicken or the egg in this case, whether Avogadro's hypothesis came before Dalton's theory or the other way around. But Avogadro's hypothesis simply said that if you have, and they're working with gases, if you have a spherical container here, say, with a gas, and a spherical container here with another gas, and they're exactly the same volume. Okay, so think of that in three dimensions. So the volume of this one is equal to the volume of that one. Okay? And the pressure inside each vessel is equal to the pressure of the other one. And we keep the temperature constant also. Okay? Avogadro said that if these conditions are all equal between these two containers, it doesn't matter what the gas is in each one. Right? This could be oxygen, this could be hydrogen, doesn't matter. As long as these conditions are equal, volume, pressure, and temperature, then the amount of each gas is equal. And that little N is what I use, my abbreviation for moles. We haven't talked about moles yet, but we will. So the number of particles of gas in this one equals the number of particles in that. That's Avogadro's hypothesis. Now, I'll talk about it again later when we get to the concept of molar mass. In other words, how much does a mole of this element weigh? What is its mass, not weight? Okay, right now we're just kind of ticking off the list. All right, that was Gay-Lussac's work with two hydrogens and one oxygen equals two waters. Occasionally, we do get mathematical equivalents, right? One of hydrogen, one of chlorine equals two of hydrogen chloride, right? But it's coincidental, right? It's not, it is chemically based, yes. But it's not rigorously, it doesn't rigorously hold to mathematical principles. All right. The explanation is that hydrogen is actually diatomic. So if you get two hydrogens here, right, they're bound together, and then you have one oxygen that's bound together, and you get two waters like that. Right, so this is two volumes of hydrogen, one volume of oxygen, based upon the Avogadro's principle. Right, if these are all at the same temperature, volume, pressure, then this one, well, actually, this one would be twice the volume because it has twice the number of particles. So this is 2 + 1 = 2. That's what that diagram is trying to explain. And this, hydrogen is diatomic, chlorine is diatomic. Remember that list with the little blue backgrounds for the elements, those diatomic elements? Chlorine's one of them. Right? So hydrogen is diatomic. Nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. So you have this inverted L right here, plus hydrogen. Those are all diatomic at room temperature and pressure. Okay. Up to this point, we've treated atoms, those elementary particles, as just like little bags of something. We don't know what's inside of. But in the latter part of the 19th century, there was a wild curiosity about this newly discovered thing called electricity. The batteries were invented, and that's, you had two ways to make, to cause an electrical discharge, so to speak, with a battery, which they didn't know how to make, or with some type of static electric generator. Right, so they have these devices with a big glass ball, and you spin it, and you hold a piece of fur against it, and it would accumulate a charge of some kind on the glass ball, and then they take it to parties, and everybody would hold hands, and then the one at the end would just touch the ball, everybody would jump, you know, and it would be like a good time in the old town of the night. Well, scientists wanted to know what those charges were. And J.J. Thomson did work. He postulated, right? He made an observation. He hypothesized that there was the existence of some negative particles called, and they were called, he called them electrons. And he went through a series of experiments to determine whether they were positive or negative charges, and then he proved that. Using a cathode ray tube. And I think I've got a video coming up here, so I'm not going to go into too much detail. But he also, with his experiments, determined the ratio of the mass of an electron to its charge. And the charge unit in those days was the coulomb, named after a Frenchman who's famous for working with electric charge. It was one unit of coulomb, was a coulomb of charge, associated with the mass of the electron. Thomson, who was an Englishman, didn't have the technology available to him to determine the actual mass of the electron. So he settled for a ratio of the charge to the mass. I guess you'd say the mass of the electron ratio to the charge, and he came up with a value. And he knew that these electrons were coming from the atoms. So the atom had to have negative charges in it. And I'm speculating here, but I'm sure they had to say, all right, they knew that negatives and positives were opposites. And if the atom was neutral, there had to be the same amount of charge in the atom as there were electrons. And so they at least came to that conclusion. And here's a model of the cathode ray tube that he used. And you could put an electric, two electric plates, positive and negative, on it and make the beam bend. Or you could put a magnet on it and make the beam bend. So with those methods, they determined that, or Thomson determined that these were negative charge. These negative particles were coming off of one plate and going to the other. And we also knew from other scientists that what the electrodes were, one electrode was negative, one was positive. So he associated the electron with those conditions.
Cathode rays are produced in a discharge tube. A vacuum pump is used to evacuate the discharge tube. The cathode of the tube is connected to the negative terminal of the battery, and the anode of the tube is connected to the positive terminal of the battery. It was observed that, at normal pressure, the gas did not allow the current to pass through it. However, when the pressure of the tube was reduced to 0.001 mmHg, and a high potential difference between 10 kV and 20 kV was applied, at the end of the tube, a glow was seen on the walls of glass tube. The rays emitted by the cathode travel towards anode. The attraction of rays towards anode reveals that the rays carry negative charge. Properties of cathode rays are: 1. When any object is placed in the path of the cathode rays, these rays cast shadows. This shows that cathode rays travel in straight line. 2. When a wheel was placed in the path of cathode rays, the wheel rotates. This shows that rays consist of some particle and some kinetic energy. 3. In the presence of an electric field, the rays are deflected towards the positive plate. This confirms that cathode rays consist of negatively charged particles. 4. In the presence of a magnetic field, the rays are deflected. This shows that the cathode rays are affected by the magnetic field.
So these electrons have mass, right? They made that wheel spin, so that they had to have mass. Okay, along comes Robert Millikan. He was an experimental physicist, chemist, in the United States in the early part of the 20th century. The technology had developed to the point, and he built his own instrument for doing this experiment, and the next video is going to show it to you, so I'm not going to talk about it too much. It's just famous. It's called the oil drop experiment, and you'll see why when you see the video. But he was able to determine the charge on a single electron in terms of coulombs. Okay, so if this one has a value, and I forget what the value is, is it there? No, this ratio, I don't know what the ratio value is, but this is a value. And this is some value here, some number. Then if he could determine the charge on a single electron, then he could plug it into this ratio and find out what the mass is. And that's what he did. Only the experiment that he developed, he did thousands of times. We call those replications. So he did them thousands of times in order to, since the electron was so small, he basically had to do them thousands of times in order to average out any errors, okay, and get a handle on the errors too. He got a Nobel Prize in Physics for his work, determining the mass of a single electron. And remember, the SI unit for mass is the kilogram. So there's the value in kilograms, 9.11 times 10 to the minus 31 kilograms. So it's pretty small, very small particle mass. So let's take a look at this video. And I may have to start this one manually.
In a series of experiments carried out between 1908 and 1917, R.A. Millikan succeeded in measuring the charge of the electron with great precision. In his experiment, a fine mist of oil was sprayed into the upper chamber with an atomizer. Some of the tiny oil droplets fell through the hole in the upper floor, and Millikan was able to determine the mass of an oil drop from its terminal velocity. Next, Millikan used an X-ray source to ionize gas molecules in the chamber. Electrons from this ionization process adhered to the oil droplets. The oil droplets now carry a negative charge. The negatively charged oil droplets can be halted by adjusting the voltage across the two plates. As the voltage across the plates is increased, the velocity of the oil drops slows. As the voltage is increased further, some drops will begin to move upward toward the positive plate. If the voltage is set just right, an oil drop can be suspended. When an oil drop is suspended, its weight, mass times acceleration due to gravity, is exactly counterbalanced by the electric force applied. The electric force applied equals the applied electric field, E, times the charge on the drop, Q. Since the mass of the oil drop, the acceleration due to gravity, and the applied electric field are known, Millikan could solve for Q, which is the charge on the drop. Millikan found that droplets had different charges, but each was a whole number multiple of a smaller charge, equal to negative 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs. Millikan concluded that this was the fundamental unit of charge, the charge of an electron. From the charge of an electron and the charge-to-mass ratio of an electron determined by Thomson using a cathode ray tube, Millikan was able to calculate the mass of an electron. The mass of an electron, 9.10 times 10 to the negative 28th grams, is an exceedingly small mass.
So this is an oversimplification of what he had to do. And it was a very tedious process, but that's the nature of science very often. Yeah. Hours and hours of boredom, punctuated by moments of ecstasy or disappointment, as the case may be. Okay, so we've got the negative charge that's part, this elementary particle, subatomic particle, is part of the atom. Right? We don't know where it's located yet, we just know it's there. Then Henri Becquerel, who was French, obviously, discovered radioactivity in uranium. So that was the big thing at the beginning of the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th century. And you hear of famous people like Marie Curie and her husband. They were very active in that stuff. In fact, they didn't understand the dangers of radiation, so she and he both eventually died of cancer, probably caused by the radiation exposure. Anyway, during his lifetime, he and others discovered and confirmed the three types of radiation, right? The one type, gamma radiation, which is, that's the small gamma letter for in Greek, is just light, high energy light. And then beta particles were high-speed electrons. They were coming from some decay process. We knew that when a radioactive nuclide decays, it changes into something else. It actually changes into a different element, or it changes into a different form of the same element. But they would emit these electrons, and we now know that both electrons originate in the nucleus. And then there were alpha particles, and these were helium nuclei. They had a 2+ charge. We'll talk about the notation here in just a minute. This means they have 2 protons, and this means they have a mass number of 4. So it doesn't mean anything to you right now, but they had this charge, and what that means is these were the heaviest particles of the radioactive sources. This is heavier, way, way heavier than that, and this one essentially has no mass. Well, we know light does have a mass of sorts. We have to talk about that later, too. So we have the source here of these particles emitted by radioactive elements, and Ernest Rutherford used that information to test a theory he had. He believed that the nucleus was the atom wasn't just a big ball with negative and positive charges scattered throughout. They have to have an equal number to be balanced. This was known as the plum pudding model. Have you ever eaten plum pudding? That's little pieces of plum scattered throughout the pudding. It's not bad. Lots of English food doesn't look very appetizing, right? I never eat kidney pie. But this was the plum pudding model, and it was common. It was the first accepted model of the atom at that time. They didn't know what these positive charges were at the time. They just knew they had to be there because the atom was neutral. And they had already identified the negatives as electrons. Well, Rutherford postulated that this model was wrong. he postulated a nuclear model in which the positive charges, such as they are located in this very dense center, and the negative charges were out here somewhere. Those electrons were out here. Right? So the way he tested it was, he took a very thin gold foil, right? He needed a very heavy atom. Gold was a good choice because they knew at that time how to make very thin gold foils, right? Not too long ago, the state capitol in the dome on the state capitol building was re-gold coated with very thin gold layers, and it didn't take much gold to do it. It was most of the expense was in the labor. But he wanted it very thin because if he had a stack of too many atoms, then there would be these atoms would be stacked like that, and he was going to fire these alpha particles at it and see what happened to them. And if he had them stacked too thick, then you'd have them arranged so that nothing would get through. Right? So he wanted them very thin, like 3 or 4 atoms thick at the most. That way, he postulated that if you fire these at that thin gold foil, that most of them would go straight through, right? Because the electrons had very little mass, right? It's mostly empty space. And then whenever they hit or glanced off a nucleus, then they would be detected on the other side. Rather than a straight line, they'd be detected off some different position. So that's how we confirmed. If this were the model, right, and the charge was distributed like that, then he should get alpha particles coming through, and every one of them should make a bright spot on the other side. Nothing to slow them down. Okay, so that's where we're headed with this gold foil experiment. There's no narration except what I gave you prior. There you go. There's the apparatus. I did leave out the slits. Why do we need those slits? You're going to see. The alpha emitter is in this lead box, and the particles come out, and they could go every which way. But you need a straight beam, otherwise you don't know when it hits the target. You know which way is straight and which way is deflected. So they have to go through the slits, a pair of slits, and the only ones that can go straight through are the ones that are lined up with the slit. You go, or like a hole here and here, right? You could come in like that, but you can only go straight like that through the second one. That's why you have a pair of slits. Then they strike the gold foil. And that circle represents detectors. It was probably in those days, it was probably a photographic plates of some kind. Okay, and that's what he got. He got patterns like that. Most of them went straight through on the other side. And a lot of them. This would be his model. There's a gold atom. Most of them go straight on through because they're so heavy that the electrons can't deflect it. But when they strike the nucleus, you get some activity. Change in directions. Okay? So that was a Rutherford's experiment that proved the nuclear model of the atom. So the negative charges are out here. Positive charges are in there. And the plum pudding model was dead. All right. There's another problem. It's the nature of experimentation. You run an experiment and you come up with 10 questions for every answer. Well, we knew we had identified electrons, identified protons, and further work determined that the charge of one electron and one proton was equal, but the masses were wildly different. The proton was over 1,000 times heavier than the electron, but it still had the same opposite magnitude charge, but opposite in sign. But when you compared the mass of the atom to what you should expect from the protons, right? This took a lot of work from other people. Then there was missing mass, right? The protons and electrons together did not account for all the mass, except for one element. Which one do you think that is? Hydrogen. It was perfect for hydrogen, because hydrogen, most hydrogens only have one electron and one proton, positive charge. So those masses agreed. But all the other elements, the masses didn't agree. So he set his student Chadwick to work, or he might have been a research associate, I can't remember which. He set Chadwick with the problem of finding out, all right, where's all this other mass? It can't have a charge. We've already accounted for all the charge. So the particle in there, they determined, was about the same mass as a proton. Not exactly, maybe just a smidge heavier, but no charge at all. And it's located in the nucleus as well. So Chadwick's work on discovering and characterizing the nucleus, there it is. He was a graduate student, right? Cheap labor. Earned him the Nobel Prize in Physics for that neutron work. Rutherford got his Nobel Prize for the nuclear model of the atom. So now we have elementary particles that make up the atom, right? Proton, neutrons, and electrons. And the nucleus is very small compared to the rest of the atom. So it's mostly empty space or filled with these low mass electrons. And an extremely dense nucleus, which is populated by protons and neutrons. And that's just a comparison. So this one at the bottom, that at the bottom shows the size of the atom, and this is the size of the nucleus. So for this particular example, you got 10 to the minus 13 and 10 to the minus 8. So are you familiar with the term orders of magnitude? Orders of magnitude mean powers of 10. So if you've got one that's minus 13 centimeters and the other one is minus 8, you've had a change of 5 orders of magnitude. Or what would that be? 10,000. 10,000 times bigger than the nucleus. Okay. Further work was done. We knew that the atom was composed of, protons inside and neutrons inside and electrons out here. But once we started getting a handle on the masses of atoms in a naturally occurring sample of a pure element, we found out that all the atoms didn't weigh the same. There were differences. So the concept of the isotope had to be invented in order to account for those differences. Well, we know that the number of protons and the number of electrons in a neutral atom determine the element. If you change the number of protons, you change the element, right? So hydrogen has one proton, helium has two, lithium has three, beryllium has four, boron has five, carbon has six, and so on. Protons. Change the protons, change the element. So if we've got the same element, we can't change the protons. And if it's neutral, we can't change the electrons. So the change among the isotopes of a different element has to occur with the neutrons. So an isotope of a different isotope of an element has a different number of neutrons. Here's an example, sodium. And now we're going to write the element. I'll use that as my element symbol. Okay. There are four positions around that we reserve for information. Okay? If we write that element in a compound or in a multi-atomic molecule, then this is the number of atoms. So a subscript over here means if there's no subscript, we assume it's one. There's one atom, two atoms, three atoms, whatever the number says. If there's a charge, it goes up here. Right? If it's neutral, we usually don't write the zero. Right? You can, but usually don't. If it's a positively charged ion, of course, we write plus or 2 plus or 3 plus or 4 plus, whatever the charge is, or minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. Over here, this position designated by Z is the number of protons, the atomic number. Number of protons. So that little p with the plus sign is a proton. This number designated by A is the mass number. And this is equal to the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. Right? So sodium here on the left and on the right, these numbers have to be the same. Right? It has to be 11 for sodium. If it's anything else, it's a different element. Right? If we accidentally put a 12 there, it would be magnesium. Right? Can't have that. If it's going to be an isotope, it's got to have the same number here. But this number is different. And so 23 for the left one, 24 for the right. So what does that mean? How many neutrons are in that? Well, if you have 11 here and you have 23 total, you have 12 neutrons in the left-hand isotope. But on the right, you have 24. So that means you would have 13 neutrons, correct? Okay. Now we are sticking to mathematical rules. 1 plus 1 does equal 2. But they have identical chemical properties. Right? They may be different weights for the individual atoms. And I use weight and mass, pardon me, but interchangeably sometimes. They have different masses. But they have the same chemical characteristics. In other words, we know sodium as a metal is very reactive, say with water. Right? It doesn't matter which isotope it is, it's the same reactivity. Right? You throw a chunk of sodium in your neighbor's swimming pool and it'll crack the bottom because it reacts violently, produces lots of gas and heat, and it just right settles to the bottom, and as soon as it gets enough heat, that's if your neighbor's dog has been peeing on your bushes or something. Okay, so those are isotopes. And in nature, if we purify sodium from the Earth's crust, we know from experience that there will be a certain ratio of isotopes. Right. There may be 2, 3, 4, 5, as many as 20 or 30 isotopes for some elements. But we have people that do this for a living. They determine the ratio of isotopes. And it's going to be essentially the same no matter where you find it in our setting. So as chemists, we don't have to deal with isotopes when we're doing experiments. We know that that's already been determined and built into information that's on the periodic table. And we'll cover that also. It's coming. And there's an explanation for the Z and the A symbols, atomic number versus mass number. There we go. So if we have 23 protons and 28 neutrons, the mass number would be 51, right? What element is that? Well, if you go to the periodic table, the way the periodic table is set up, it's just chock full of information. So we're going to bleed it out slowly. The atomic numbers are assigned to each element, hydrogen being one, and it goes left to right, top to bottom. So you go left, right, 1, 2, then 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, then you go back, 11, 12. So they get bigger as you go down. So we can find 51 is right here. Mass number is 51. All right. Let's look at 23 protons, right? 23 protons.
Yeah, here.
Vanadium. It has to be vanadium to have 23 protons. But while we're at it, 51 mass number, if you look down here, that's almost 51, 50.94. You can also identify an element by its mass, and we'll do that later. So there's vanadium with its 23 protons. Okay, let's see. I thought there was going to be a discussion about... hold on a second. Let me look at my hard copy. Only got 15 minutes left. By the way, if I run over and you have to be somewhere, then just up and go. Right? If it's a quarter till and you've got to go to another class or you have a babysitter that has to be relieved or something like that, just go ahead. And I'll keep talking and the recording will be posted. but I was looking for... Okay, it's not in the slides yet. I will say this about the atomic number. When the periodic table was first developed, and we're going to look at the periodic table in detail later in a subsequent chapter, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it now. And that may be where this discussion is located, but I can't help myself. The atomic number, these elements are arranged in order of atomic number. Right? They were just given arbitrarily. They didn't have any experimental evidence for them. They didn't know what they were when Mendeleev put this thing together. He actually put it together based on a mass of elements. They didn't know about protons then. But the atomic number is derived from experimental work by... And it's going to just aggravate me until I can remember the man's name. Moseley. Henry Moseley. He was an Englishman working with X-ray spectra of metals. And what he discovered was that the frequency, and we use this Greek letter nu, the frequency of the element, if you take the square root of it, is proportional to that atomic number. He had a formula, and all he had to do to determine the X-ray spectrum of a given element was to put in a whole number for each of the elements. So if you wanted to know the X-ray spectrum for, say, cadmium, he put in 48. He wanted to know the X-ray spectra for cobalt, you put in 27. So these numbers were now linked experimentally with the numbers that were on the chart. Unfortunately, Henry Moseley did his work in 1913 and 1914, and World War I broke out. And he volunteered to serve for the English. And with his electrical background, he was a perfect candidate for a communications officer. So he went with his army, whatever that was, to a place in Turkey called Gallipoli, which, militarily speaking, was a disaster. Lots of Englishmen died, and he was one of them. So that was the end of his scientific career. Who knows what he could have accomplished. All right, so bonding. We're going to speak in sort of thin layer terms about bonding at this point. We'll get into bonding in a little more detail in the last two chapters of this semester. But for now, when two atoms bind together, say, two hydrogen atoms, how do you think the bond forms? The nucleus is not going to give up its protons to form a bond of any kind. Bonding occurs with, what do those atoms see first when they come together? Electrons. Electrons are out here. Bonding takes place among electrons of atoms. Now, if electrons are completely transferred from one atom to the other, and you form a charge. Like for sodium, what we have, 11? Wasn't it 11? Yeah, 11. So sodium has 11 protons, and it's neutral. It also has 11 electrons, right? 11 electrons and 11 protons, right? So what sodium likes to do, and all of its kin in that first column called alkaline metals, they like to give up an electron. That's it, just one electron. So if sodium gives up one electron, now it's 10, what's the charge on that ion? Right. You form ions by gaining or losing electrons. You can't mess with the protons. Why? Because if you change the protons, you change the element. So all the charges depend upon electron addition or subtraction. So it loses an electron, now it has an imbalance of what? One plus charge. Right? Those 10 electrons only balance 10 of these. That means one extra proton with that positive charge. So sodium will be that negative charge if it transfers an electron. Well, where is it going to transfer the electron? Well, suppose there's chlorine sitting out here. Right? And chlorine has 17. Everybody in chlorine's party, in that column, the halogens, they like to gain electrons. In fact, one electron per atom is perfect. So if this gains one electron, now instead of 17, it has 18 electrons. It's got a negative charge. Well, if that electron was transferred from sodium, right, that's perfect. It loses an electron, chlorine gains an electron, they're both happy. Right? So now, the bond that forms between these two, since the electron was completely transferred, you have a positive charge here, negative charge here, you have an ionic, a Coulombic attraction. Right? Positives attract negatives. That's an ionic bond. Right? But suppose you have these two hydrogens together, right? We know they're bound together, right? They're one of the diatomic elements. Right? This one has one proton. It also has one electron and one electron. But who gets what? Nobody wins, right? So they share. Right? They share two electrons between them like that. And you form a bond there. That's called a covalent bond when you share electrons. The complete covalent bond. That's what we're talking about there. And that forms a molecule. For molecules, sharing electrons, forming a covalent bond, you form a molecule because now this behaves as a single unit. Okay? All covalently bound atoms together form molecules. These don't form molecules, because they're purely electrostatic. In fact, have you ever spilled salt on a table and looked at it with a magnifying glass? No, am I the only one that does that stuff? What's the shape? The shape is a cube. Right? It forms a cube because up here, now here, and behind and in front are all these negative chloride ions surrounding that positive. But each one of the chlorides also has sodium surrounding it. So you have a network of negative and positive charges. That's why this is not molecular, this is. This doesn't form discrete molecules of Na and Cl. It forms a network of positive and negative charges. And however many there are in it, is the size of the cube. Right? So instead of writing sodium 10 to the third and chlorine 10 to the third, right? We write the simplest whole number ratio, 1 to 1. Okay? Now there's a name. We call the positive charges the cations. and the negative charged particles, the anions. Just memorize rather than try to explain.
So this is a video that addresses the question that students often have, what is the difference between a formula unit and a molecular formula? And that brings up a couple of questions itself. What are the structural differences between ionic and molecular compounds? And how do those differences affect their chemical formulas? So the chemical formula for a covalent compound is a molecular formula. And the chemical formula for an ionic compound is called a formula unit. So an example of a molecular formula, H2O, which is water, and for a formula unit, NaCl, the formula unit of common table salt. So what's the diff? And if we look at the structure visually, I think we can see very much what the difference is. So let's first look at sodium chloride. This will be our example ionic compound. NaCl does not exist as a single unit, like a molecule, and this goes for all ionic compounds. So this would not be a valid way to represent sodium chloride. And like any ionic compound, in the solid state, sodium chloride exists as a crystal. So a very, 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 very tiny crystal would look like this with alternating sodium and chloride, and a little bit of a different view. The formula unit is NaCl, but if we look inside the crystal, the sodium and chloride ions are actually bonded to six oppositely charged neighbors. So if we shrink the ions, we can take a better look inside, and it's a little bit hard to see. So what we're going to do is take a look at a particular chloride ion, that one right there, and ask the question, how many sodium ions is the chloride ion close enough to bond with? Let's start with the head-on view first, and as we change the perspective, you can see there are exactly six sodium ions that the chloride ions is equidistant and can bond to. If we ask the same question of sodium, how many chloride ions can it bond to? Well, again, there are six chloride ions that it's equidistant to, and therefore the sodium ion also bonds to six chloride ions. So as you go throughout the crystal, you can see that is always the case. Because each sodium is bonded to more than one chloride ion, and each chloride ion is bonded to more than one sodium ion, then you can think of all the ions in the whole crystal part of one single bonded unit. And the crystal below would be Na32Cl32. So you can imagine that would be very impractical given the enormous numbers of ions in a crystal large enough to see with our eyes. So only the ratio of ions is given, and that would be its empirical formula. But we call the empirical formula of an ionic compound the formula unit. And sodium chloride is the formula unit for the sodium chloride crystal, and it is the smallest whole number ratio of sodium and chloride ions in the crystal. So all formula units are the smallest whole number ratio of the ions in the crystal. That goes for all formula units. Here's another example, calcium fluoride. You've got one calcium for every two fluorides. The calcium is 2+, the fluoride is 1-. It has a slightly different crystal structure to account for. Rather than the 1-to-1 ratio of sodium chloride, you have a 1-to-2 ratio of calcium fluoride. And if we shrink the atoms to take a better look, and see how the calcium is connected to the fluorides, you can see that each calcium has eight nearest fluoride neighbors, and so it is equally bonded to those eight fluoride neighbors. And if we look at the fluorine, each fluoride has four closest calcium neighbors. And again, like sodium chloride, the whole crystal acts as one single bonded unit, and so we need to express the formula as the lowest whole number ratio being CaF2. So what about molecules? How are they different? Let's take a look at water. We've got the space-filling model on the left, ball and stick model on the right, It's covalently bonded hydrogen and oxygen. And a collection of water molecules is just that, a collection of individual units of H2O that are covalently bonded single units of two hydrogens and one oxygen. They're not connected to each other except by weak forces. And so large amounts of H2O, any attraction between the water molecules due to weak forces, the molecules behave, they still behave as individual units, not one large bonded unit, as in an ionic crystal. Another view of water, here the hydrogens are white instead of yellow. And this I'm showing you to contrast more specifically with the sodium chloride or the calcium fluoride, because we showed the ionic crystals as solids, and here's water as a solid, ice of course. And here, like ionic compounds, molecular compounds also form crystals in the solid state, a very ordered structure that you can see here. If we take a closer look, however, we can see that each H2O remains as a single unit and is not covalently bonded to any other H2O. The attractions that hold them in place are, of course, the very, very strong dipole, the hydrogen bonding, that occurs between the hydrogen and the oxygen. But that is much, much, much weaker than the covalent bond between the hydrogen and the oxygen, and the H2O therefore remains a single unit. So we look at these structural differences between molecules and ionic compounds by how we express them in their formulas. The molecule is represented by a molecular formula showing all the atoms present in the unit. The ionic compound is represented by the ratio of its ions, and that is called a formula unit. So here's the H2O molecule, and here versus the NaCl formula unit. Many sodiums and many chlorides, yet it's still just expressed as the lowest whole number ratio. It's one sodium to one chloride. In summary, in a molecule, the atoms given by the formula are all covalently bonded. In a collection of those molecules, molecules are attracted to each other by weak forces, but no covalent bonds occur between the molecules. The molecules exist as individual units of covalently bonded atoms. But in an ionic compound where the bond is the electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged ions, each ion is bonded to each of its oppositely charged neighbors. So for any ionic compound, all the ions in the whole crystal can be thought of as part of one single bonded unit. So the formula unit shows the lowest whole number ratio of the ions rather than representing very awkwardly all the ions in the crystal, which in most cases would be impossible to determine anyway. So that is the difference between a formula unit and a molecular formula.
Here we go. Because we still haven't got the naming compounds and I'm about out of time. I think we're about out of time, aren't we? 140. We start at 12:30 and runs to 1:45. Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna skip this one too. Right, you can calculate that. Maybe I better not. Say we have this ion like that, and it has 54 electrons, right? And it has 78 neutrons. What's the mass number? Well, it's there, but I'm going to show you how we got it. If this is a positive ion and we have 54 electrons, how many protons do we have? Right, you got one extra positive, don't you? That's not neutralized by electrons, so it has to have 55 protons, correct? 55 protons would be 55 positive charges against 54 negatives, gives you one excess positive. Okay, so this would be 55, all right? And if you have 78 neutrons, then 55 plus 78 is 331, right? 133. All right, out of curiosity, what's that element? 55? Cesium, CS. That's cesium. And notice when we write these things, we always write them as, if there's only one letter, like hydrogen or oxygen, it's just the capital letter. But if we have to add a letter on it because right? C is already taken for carbon, so we have to add another letter for cesium. The second letter is always small. If you write it like this, it's wrong. That's carbon and sulfur. Okay? All right. this is, well, we know that elements are made of tiny particles is still true. Compounds have the same relative number of atoms. That's true. Dalton's atomic theory. All atoms of a given element are identical. No, we know that's not true anymore because of isotopes. Now, chemically, they're identical, but you can't say just blanket statement they're identical, because each atom of a different isotope has a different mass. Atoms are indestructible. We know that's not true anymore either. All right. So when we look at the periodic table, and this will help you with that extra credit, right, for the periodic table. Metals versus nonmetals. The periodic table can be subdivided into various groups. On this one, we have this red line right here. It goes down between aluminum and silicon, and then it goes over between germanium and arsenic, and then stair steps like that. On this side are the nonmetals. On this side are the metals. So most of the periodic table is metals. And they have characteristics. Metals are different than nonmetals. Hopefully we'll be able to discuss that in more detail later. But the table can also be grouped into, to be redundant, groups or families. Actually, I learned them as families, but now we call them groups. And they're in the verticals. Okay. Now, what's special about the groups? Well, every member of the same group has similar chemical properties. They're not identical, but they're similar. All the halogens behave a certain way. All the alkaline metals behave a certain way. All alkaline earths behave a certain way. All halogens behave a certain way. All noble gases don't behave at all. Right? They don't play with anybody. All the chalcogens, right, the oxygen group, they behave a certain way. All the nictogens, they behave a certain way. And the carbon groups are similar in borons by itself. So when you reach this divider, it changes the story, right? So, except for this one, right? The line goes down here, so all of these halogens behave similarly. And the periodic table is also arranged with periods. That's why we call it the periodic table. These rows are called periods. What was discovered was that if you increase the mass of each element and they get bigger and bigger and bigger from left to right, eventually you get over here. And if you keep going, then you're trying to create another family that's already been created. Right? So the one over on this side, 37, is going to be rubidium. And rubidium behaves like all these other guys. So we stop at that end of this row and we start a new row. That way we keep the families in order. And that's called a period. Does anybody have physics in here? Study periodic motion, what periodic motion is? Well, it's the object is moving, right? But it's not going anywhere, right? It's like a pendulum on a clock. It's moving, but it goes up here, up there, and comes back. It goes up there, comes back to the same place. Right? That's periodic motion. So the period of a table comes back, goes back to the same place. Starts over again, goes back to the same place. Okay, that's why we call them a period. Okay, so there's a diagram. And it has some of the family names are in there. You might have to look up the others, and they should be in your textbook, actually, when you're filling out that extra credit thing. Yeah, I'm out of time. So if you have to go ahead, and I'll just keep talking. Characteristics of these groups. Right? The alkaline metals, that first group, when they form ions, they always form plus one charges. The alkaline earths, the next group over on the right, form two plus charges, alkaline metals. The halogens, when they form ions, they always form minus one charge. And of course, the noble gases are always zero. All right, now I'm going to name compounds. Right? I know you're going to kick yourself for missing this part. Watch the video. All right, we're going to start out really simple. Binary compounds. What's a binary compound? Binary compound has two parts to it. It has a left-hand part and a right-hand part. If it's an ionic compound, the left-hand part is the positive charge, and the right-hand part is the negative charge. Okay? And it's always formed between some metal and some non-metal. Right? So this is an alkaline metal, right? First group. This is a halogen, non-metal. Okay? Binary covalent compounds are always formed from nonmetals. So, for instance, carbon dioxide. Carbon's a nonmetal. Oxygen's a nonmetal. Okay. So that would be a binary covalent compound. Okay. For naming purposes, we can subdivide all the compounds on a binary level into three different types, right? So type one is a metal non-metal, right? Metal non-metal, I should write N-O-N. Might mistake that for nitrogen. Metal non-metal. The cation, this part right here, is formed from an element that has only one possible charge associated with it. No other charge is possible. Now, where do we find those? We find those in this first group, plus one charges, plus two charges, plus three charges, and let's see, copper, silver, and I believe cadmium. Those also have fixed charges. Those would fit under type one. Now, how do we name them? Well, the metal side, the cation, you just use the element name. So for sodium chloride, right, we know it's like this. We would say sodium. And you add an IDE on the end. Instead of chlorine, we say chloride. So sodium chloride would be that compound. Right? So what if we had the neighbor of sodium, magnesium? Magnesium chloride. How would we write that compound, though? Well, we need the element, right? Mg, magnesium, and we need the chlorine right there. But is that the right ratio, right? With all compounds are neutral. So if the chlorine, the halogen, has to have minus one charge, right, because it's from that group. Magnesium is from the second group over. It has a plus two charge. So how do we balance the charges? You need two negatives to balance that one positive. So you need two anions to balance that one cation. Okay? And you can do that with any of them. Let's pick a different one. These are always minus two. Right? So if we had an oxygen here, and we had, a potassium. Potassium is an alkaline metal, it's a plus one charge, right? Oxygen is a two minus charge, so we need two positives to balance the oxygen. So it'd be K2O would be the formula for that one. How would we name it? Well, Since that metal is a fixed charge, it can only be one charge, none other. It's an alkaline metal, always plus one. We just say potassium oxide. You'll also notice when you're memorizing these symbols, some of them are not derived from the English word. Right? Where does K come from? Potassium? It doesn't. Potassium, some of them are Latin extracts. So in Latin, this is kalium. That's where the K comes from. But when we name it, we don't say kalium oxide. We say potassium oxide. That's the type 1 compound. Okay, those are the easiest ones. And there are some examples. Calcium has a 2 plus charge. Oxygen has a 2 minus charge. So you only need one of each. And the charge balances. Type 2 compounds. Type 2s are also metal, non-metal. The difference is in the cation. The metal comes from a part of the periodic table where that metal, depending on it, the compound that it's in, could have multiple charges. Right. It could ionize to one charge in one reaction. It could ionize to a different charge in a different reaction to make a different compound. So what we need is a way to distinguish what the charge is because it's not fixed. So, for example, iron can be a 2 plus or a 3 plus, depending on the compound. But if it's a 2 plus and we combine it with oxygen, right, a 2 minus and a 2 plus, just need one of each, right? Now, how do you name it? Well, we say iron, just like type 1 compounds, iron oxide, but we have to specify what the charge is. And for these metals, it's always a positive charge, so you don't have to put a positive in there. Just with a Roman numeral, you say it's a plus 2 charge. Iron 2 oxide is this compound. What if we form the same compound with iron and oxygen, only if it's iron 3 plus? Okay, so we got iron, got oxygen. This one's a 2 minus, this one's a 3 plus. Okay, we're stuck. We can't just change the number of 1 and get the answer. So when you're faced with this type of arrangement, cross multiply. Remember that from math class? Bring that 2 over here, bring this 3 over here. And you can check yourself, right? If you have 3 oxygen ions with a 2 minus each, the total charge is a 6 minus, correct? 3 times 2 minus. For 2 irons at 3 plus each is a 6 plus. So it balances out. Okay, now how do we name it? Well, we do it the same way as before, except we change the charge designation in the name to 3. It's an iron 3 oxide. The metals that fit in this category, most of them come from the transition metals right here. This group right there. Some of them over here also. Okay. And there's some examples. Let me come back to this one. Polyatomics. Let's go to type 3 first, and we'll come back to the polyatomics. Type 3 compounds are non-metal, non-metal. Now, how are you going to balance a charge with a non-metal, non-metal? Because we know that 2 non-metals make, when they're bonded, they do so by sharing electrons. They don't transfer electrons, so you don't make ions with non-metal, non-metals. So what we do is we borrow from type 1 and type 2 convention, and we put one first and the other second. And we just say in the name how many of each there are. And to do that, we need the Greek prefixes for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 10, as our lives ask you. So let's see on the next slide, I think. Yeah, there it is. So mono is 1, di is 2, tri, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, and deca, down 1 through 10. Those are the prefixes. So for example, if we're given this compound, you just be given the name, C2. Everybody knows that as carbon dioxide. Well, it's carbon dioxide because of type 3 naming convention. We don't say monocarbon when it's first. We just say carbon. And the second one, we say di for 2 oxide. Like that. Okay. That's bad enough, but this would be worse. What would this be? Carbon monoxide. That's the real killer right there. Carbon monoxide. So if you use space heaters in your house in the winter and the gases combust incompletely, it'll produce a lot of carbon monoxide. And if you're not well ventilated in your house, it could kill you. Now some of them had common names, like this one. We don't say dihydrogen monoxide, right? We say water. But by this convention, it would be a dihydrogen monoxide. Okay, so let me go back to polyatomic ions. See that right? Yeah, polyatomics. So where do polyatomics fit in here? Well, that list, and I'm not sure, is that list in the, if you can see it, that's awful small. Did I hand out a list of polyatomics?
No.
Okay. It is in Brightspace, right, the separate document, because that's kind of small to read the polyatomics. And there are polyatomics in your textbook, but they may not be as complete as the list that I gave you. So where do polyatomics fit in? Well, a polyatomic ion behaves as a single ion. Okay. So for instance, with this first one, the hydroxyl, that's the hydroxide polyatomic ion. So if you combine it with any other metal here or here, then all you have to do is follow rule 1 or rule 2. So if we did sodium, it would be sodium hydroxide. And the name is given. You don't change the name. It's given in the list. That's the hydroxide, so it's sodium hydroxide. And you still have to balance the chart because it's metal. And the polyatomic ions are all nonmetals. Nitrate is like that. So if you combine it with magnesium, which is a 2+ charge, now you need two of these one negatives. How do you do that? Well, with polyatomic ions, you have to keep them intact. You cannot bust them apart. You cannot change their subscripts. So this means, with the parentheses, you need 2 of them, because that negative charge is distributed over the entire polyatomic ion. Okay? There's only one, all but one of the polyatomics are negative charges. Only one that's positive charge. That's the ammonium ion. So you can have two polyatomics combined together, and that's what this ammonium sulfate is. If you have to go ahead. I'll probably be here for another half hour anyway. But I will post it ASAP. So there's your list of polyatomic ions. And in Brightspace, you'll get a bigger picture of it. What you'll notice is with this list is the left-hand side and the right-hand side are the same polyatomic ions. They're just organized differently. Yes?
Do we need Cengage?
Yes.
Okay. I just wanted to double check.
Yeah, you need it to do the homework.
Okay. Great, thank you.
On the left-hand side, they're ordered by alphabetical of the name. So you have arsenate, arsenite, azide, benzoate, on down. On the right-hand side, they're in order of the formulas. Right. So if you need to look them up, if you're looking up a formula to name it, or you look on the right-hand side, if you're looking for the name to write the formula, you look on the left-hand side. And this list of polyatomics, actually, I think I did give you a copy of that. It's in the review document. Look in the review document in the useful information part in the back, and you should find that list. So you don't have to make a separate copy. Right. You don't have to memorize those. Just learn how to use that list to find your polyatomics and learn how to recognize polyatomics. Most polyatomics have at least two elements. Well, I have to have two. They usually have two or three, most of the time, elements bound together in a single unit that has a charge. All right. So there are some examples of type threes. This is a flow chart that you're welcome to use if you want. Now, naming acids. First thing you have to do when you're naming an acid is to identify the acid. You have to know that you have an acid before you can name it as an acid. How do we know we have an acid? Well, all acids begin their formulas with hydrogen, at least one, sometimes more. So that hydrogen makes this a potential acid. This one, right, another type. This one, another type. And notice, this is a polyatomic ion. This is a polyatomic ion. And you can find it in that list. But this makes it an acid. Except for one thing. All acids must be dissolved in water. So, if this were a gas, a pure gas, like that, we would name this hydrogen chloride, right? But if we put it in water, if we dissolve it in water, and that's what AQ means, aqueous. So we put it in water, now it becomes an acid, and we have to use a different naming convention. And I'll tell you in just a minute what that is. So all these have to be dissolved in water to be acids. The other condition is, do you find oxygen anywhere in the formula? Right. There's no oxygen in this one. There is oxygen here. There is oxygen there. We name them differently. If there's no oxygen, then you start the name with hydro. Okay? Then you take the second part of the name, and you change the ide to ic. So chloride means chloric. Hydrochloric acid. Okay? The other example there, right below it, is HCN. CN is the polyatomic ion, cyanide ion, with a negative charge. So the hydrogen has to be a plus, nominally speaking, and negative. But how do you name it? Well, there's no oxygen, so we start off with hydro. And then instead of cyanide, we say cyanic. There we go. So that's how you name acids with no oxygen in the name. If you have oxygen in the name, then you don't say hydro. You go straight to the polyatomic ion. and work from there. So this polyatomic ion is sulfate, right? Sulfate. In this convention, if that's a sulfate, then you end the name with IC, ick. Eights become icks. Only sulfic doesn't sound right. So, but, you know, chemists have sensitive hearing too. So instead of that, we say sulfuric acid. Okay? This is phosphate. So we say that's phosphoric acid. Okay? That's the difference. First, you have to have the hydrogen, you have to dissolve it in water, and then you look for oxygens to differentiate the naming conventions. Eights become icks. What if we have something like this? H2SO3, right? There's a difference. This is sulfate, this is sulfite. Ites become us, so this would be sulfurous acid. Okay? C2H3O2, you probably need to know that. Well, this acid, HC2H3O2, this is the polyatomic ion acetate. Right? So there's oxygen, we don't say hydro. So this would be eights become icks, so we say acetic acid. Okay? And all these would be aqueous. That's just understood now. Everybody knows acetic acid, right? If you like vinegar in any shape or form, you are consuming acetic acid. Okay. There's ites become uses. And there's another flow chart if you want to use it. Which one is named incorrectly? Well, the first one is potassium is the metal. Nitrate is the polyatomic. You treat it as a nonmetal. Nitrate is polyatomic with a minus one charge. Potassium is a plus one charge. That's correct. TiO2. Titanium and oxide, CO2, yeah. Okay, this would be, oxygen is a 2 minus charge, so a total of 4 minuses, right? 2 times 2 minuses, 4 minuses total. This has to balance that much. So this one titanium must have a 4 plus charge. And when we write the name, it should be titanium. Is it type 1 or type 2? Well, look where titanium comes from, the transition metals. So it could have more than one possible charge. So we have to specify. Roman numeral 4, oxide. Okay? That one is false, right? Titanium 2 oxide is wrong. Now, one point I didn't make before about the naming convention, IUPAC, International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry. There, a subcommittee of that group proposes and determines naming conventions. So they're responsible for these rules. Two things are considered when a naming convention is developed. One is that it's unambiguous. In other words, the name that's proposed, the rule that governs the naming, cannot be anything else. It must be unique for that compound. And it's not just unambiguous, it's also non-redundant. That is, we don't We give just enough information to make sure that it's unambiguous, and we don't give more information than we need by duplicating input, right? Unambiguous and non-redundant. Okay, so that's the bad one. The rest of them are good. Now, this is the last slide. I stuck this one in here because you're going to encounter it in one of your lab experiments. So you need to know this. Plus, when you work that extra credit called 50 Ways to Name the Compound, you also need to know this rule. These are waters of hydration. Many compounds, when they precipitate out of aqueous solution, they bring some water with them. And when you filter them out and you dry them, air dry them, even heat them to, say, 100 degrees, what you find is that some of that water stays behind in the crystal structure of the compound. Those are called waters of hydration. Now, you can force those waters out. You can produce that compound, what we call anhydrous, an being not. Anhydrous, no water. You can do that. And that's how we determine how much water is actually sticking to those molecules, those compounds, when we dry them only at 100 degrees. So our example here is zinc sulfate. Right. Actually, I think zinc is one of those with a fixed charge. Right. This is a 2+ charge, nothing else. So it would be a type 1 naming convention. We would say zinc sulfate because that's the polyatomic ion with a 2- charge. But it does have water associated with it. In fact, it has, for every one of these, like that, ZnSO4, it has 7 waters associated in that ratio with one of those. So it's going to have 7 waters in the crystal structure by the ratio of 1 to 7. So when we write the compound, we write this as zinc sulfate, and then we put a dot in the middle of the line, not on the line, but in the middle. And then to add to the name, we use the Greek prefix for 7, which is hepta. And then we name water as hydrate. So this compound as written is zinc sulfate heptahydrate. Okay? So that's all I have to say about naming for now. We need to practice it. Okay? So the next time we meet, let me see. I missed that. Let me see what the chat is. Somebody's chatting at me. Oh, I see. Okay. I understand. Losing service while on the road. Okay. This is the last slide, and that's all I'm going to say about chapter 2 for the lecture. What we'll do is next Tuesday, we'll pull out the review document. Yes, next Tuesday, the 29th, we'll get the review document. So you need to look at that review document, work as many of those problems, answer as many questions as you can, and then we'll use the entire hour and a quarter, maybe more, whatever it takes. Because we'll also have a lab time after that, and review chapters 1 and 2. And then we'll also, I think we'll also get into, we'll also get into lab exercise 1, graphing techniques. Right? So we'll probably use a little bit of that time to finish the review, and then we'll get into graphing techniques with that first lab before we're finished. Okay, that's it for today.